Hey everyone, this is Casey. Today I'm going to show you how to create this sketchbook style using Sketch and Toon in Cinema 4D. In this project, I want to present various forms of music players in an observational way, so that's why I went with this sketchbook-inspired style. To get a hand-drawn effect, I use Cinema 4D's spline sketch mode. This can let us draw splines freely. Then I can assign a sketch material to the splines and turn on the spline option. Cinema 4D Sketch and Toon is super powerful. It has plenty of settings to make our lines look dynamic. So based on the references, I focus on tweaking adjustments, distort, thickness, and clone to achieve this look. Meanwhile, I can use projection deformer or snap on polygon to get these strokes stick to the surface of the objects. However, drawing each object manually isn't practical, so we also need a procedural approach. For object strokes, I assign the sketch material to our objects and mainly use the folds, creases, and border options. For fills, I didn't use the usual cell shader since it has fewer options for me to control. Instead, I just use the contour option in the sketch material, which renders lines based on equal angle or height. So by increasing the thickness and lowering the opacity, I can create this kind of subtle fills that match the sketchbook vibe perfectly. Next, I will demonstrate this shader step by step. First thing first, we want to go to the project settings and make sure that we are having the basic color management and the sRGB color profile. Then in the render settings, we want to make sure that we select the standard renderer and we will add a sketch and tune effect. You can see now we already have this default sketch material created. Even if we haven't assigned this material to the object, it automatically has lines. So I'll uncheck these default options in the line settings. Similarly, I will also disable the default object shading in the shading tab. Now we can assign this material to the object and let's increase the thickness a little bit. It's looking good right now, but if we zoom out, we can tell that the thickness actually gets heavier and it's quite strange. So under the render tab, we want to turn on the resolution independence. This can ensure the line thickness remains consistent visually. By the way, if you download my project file, you can save these settings as a preset and use it for your own project. By the way, I'm using Albums D's cassette tape model for this tutorial. Big shout out to them. Feel free to download it if you want to follow along. Back to our scene, our object has this default grayish shading. We don't want this, so we'll create a new material, disable its color and reflectance channel, and enable luminance channel. We're gonna have pure white as the color. Now, if we assign this material to the object, we can see the tape blending with the background. Next, I will start with this cube. It's the main body of the tape. Let's move the sketch material to this cube. And by default, we'll have folds, creases, and border options selected. The problem right now is that we can't assign different sketch materials to different sketch types. So the quick solution is to select both in the line materials dropdown. Now, input slots are available for each different sketch type. Since we'll start with the object fill, so let's disable these options first and enable the contour. Let's drag the sketch material we created earlier to the contour slots. And let's actually rename this material as fill. If we preview it, we can already see these striped lines. The position mode is usually a great choice, allowing us to adjust rotation, variation, and more. However, in this case, I'll use the UVW mode with the V option to create these intersecting horizontal and vertical lines. After this, we can start to adjust the stroke settings. First, I will change the color and lower the opacity. Currently, the opacity is uniformly set to 30% with no variation. So we'll check the noise modifier. And you can see the opacity now follows a noise pattern. We'll increase the scale to 1000% to make the variation appear less frequent and also lower the strength a bit. We can also notice that the line lengths are uniformed, making them look very mechanical and not at all like hand-drawn lines. So let's go into the adjustment section to make some tweaks. Parameters in this section are quite self-explanatory, so I will speed up a bit. In short, we will make subtle adjustments to each parameter and add some variations. After these adjustments, our lines will have some changes in length and rotation. Moving on, I'd like to go to the clone section and enable clone strokes. This will duplicate our existing lines. I'll reduce the repeat value to 2, and just like in the adjustment section earlier, I will make some tweaks to the parameters and add variations. This way, the clone effect will appear more organic. There are no fixed values for these parameters, so I highly recommend experimenting based on your own situation. The last thing we want to modify is the thickness. I'll first increase the thickness to 40 so that the lines can roughly cover the model. Then I'll use the noise modifier to add some variation to the thickness. Similarly, we'll increase the noise scale to reduce the frequency of the variation. I feel like the opacity is still a bit high, so let's lower it further. With that, the sketchbook style procedural fill is complete. Let's move on to the procedural strokes. To start, we can first check the folds, creases, and the border types in the sketch material. We'll notice that the fill material is still applied to these types. This is because the fill is assigned to the default visible by default. So let's clear it. Now we can create a new sketch material and drag it into these slots. During this process, we can observe what kind of strokes are generated for each type. In this case, I've selected all three, but you can decide which one to check based on your situation. Every project is different and there's no fixed solution. Actually, I don't want to start from a completely new sketch material, since we've already made a lot of adjustments in our fill material. So I'll first duplicate the fill, rename it to stroke yellow, and then hold down Alt to drag stroke yellow onto the new sketch material. This way, stroke yellow replaces the new sketch material. We want the strokes to appear more solid, so first I will increase opacity. The strength of the noise modifier can be reduced as well. Next, I will reduce the number of repetitions in the clone strokes and decrease the offset amount slightly. Of course, we want the strokes to be thinner, so reducing the thickness is essential. Similarly, I will lower the strength of the noise modifier and decrease the noise scale to make the variations more frequent. Here, I've additionally enabled screen angle, which can modify the thickness based on the line's direction on the computer screen. I use the spline tab to remap the thickness variation, making it feel more organic. Similarly, I enable joint angle. This can modify thickness based on the angle of the joints in the stroke. The nitty-gritty behind these modifiers is quite complex and I can't say I fully understand them. However, what I will do is to try them out and see which works best for me. Finally, let's also add distorts to the strokes. Obviously, the frequency of distortion changes is too high, so we'll increase the scale and detail. Then we'll raise the displays to make the distortion more noticeable. It might be a bit too much at this point, so let's dial down the strength and displays. Okay, cool. I also want an additional black stroke, so we'll duplicate stroke yellow, rename it, and drag it into the creases visible slot. Of course, the first thing to do is to change the color to black. Next, I want to differentiate the black stroke from the yellow one, making it more solid, structured, and straightforward. So I'll increase the opacity, remove the distort, remove the transform in the clone settings, and also decrease the strength of joint angle and screen angle in the thickness setting. This looks good to me. Let's also assign this completed sketch material to other objects. We are almost there. Let's add some manual touch before wrapping up. We can select the spline sketch and enable snapping, checking only polygon. This allows us to freely write or draw on the model. I draw directly with the mouse, so the lines are a bit jagged, but we can use this handy spline smooth tool to make the spline smoother. Furthermore, we can add spline primitives like segments to the scene. I will assign stroke black to these splines and check only the splines type. In the preview, we can see they work well. Only having yellow and black strokes can be a bit boring. Additionally, I draw some marker style splines and assign them a blue sketch material. This blue stroke is duplicated from the yellow one. I increase the thickness and clone number while reducing the distort settings accordingly. Finally, let's move on to the compositing stage. After rendering, I added paper textures, turbulent displays, posterized time, and some color grading in After Effects to give this scene more of a sketchbook feeling. So that's all for today's tutorial. I hope you enjoy it. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe. If you want to dive deeper, feel free to download my project file. This is Casey, and see you next time.